session, we'll see about treatment of thyrotoxicosis due to Graves' disease. To give an overview of what are we going to see in this session, we'll see about the pathogenesis of the disease. We'll see what are the treatment modalities available for thyrotoxicosis due to Graves' disease. We'll also see when to choose radioactive iodine and when not to choose. And regarding pharmacotherapy, what are the strategies available for pharmacotherapeutic treatment, which drug to select, how much to start, how to titrate, how long to continue treatment, when a patient is said to have achieved remission, and what should we do if relapse occurs. So this is what in store for us in this session. So let us go into the session. First, about a small intro about Graves' disease. Graves' disease is the most common cause for thyrotoxicosis. This is the most common cause for thyrotoxicosis. And this is an autoimmune disorder in which there is thyroid stimulating hormone receptor antibodies. These antibodies stimulate the thyroid gland and increase their synthesis and secretion of thyroid hormone, leading to thyrotoxicosis. Now coming to what are the treatment modalities available for this disease, we have three modalities available. The first one is pharmacotherapy. The second modality of treatment is radioactive iodine. The third modality of treatment is surgery. So there are three modalities of treatment available for this condition. Now let us see which modality is preferred. Now if you look into the general consensus, radioactive iodine is preferred in United States. This is the primary modality of treatment in United States. Whereas in other countries like European countries, Australia, Japan, India, pharmacotherapy is the primary modality of treatment for this disease. So Europe, Australia, Japan, India, all these countries, pharmacotherapy is the primary modality of treatment for this condition. Now having said the modalities, before we go on to the primary modality in these countries, the pharmacotherapy, a small word about radioactive iodine. Now, radioactive iodine has a few advantages, like say for example, single dose is effective in treating the patients, and it is very easy to administer. It is administered orally and it is cost effective. The most cost effective modality of treatment as far as Graves' disease goes is radioactive iodine. A small note about when or which kind of patients are most suited for radioactive iodine. Now first, and the most important, is patients with substantial comorbid conditions or like with heart disease, like with heart failure, patients with heart failure and pulmonary hypertension. These patients, radioactive iodine is more preferred. Patients in whom the pharmacotherapy is contraindicated are also preferred this thing for radioactive iodine therapy. The third is when pharmacotherapy is a failure. It does not maintain the patient on euthyroid state, then we need to change to radioactive iodine. Having said when it is, we should also see when it should not be used. So when not radioactive iodine. Now the first and the most important criteria where it should not be used radioactive iodine is pregnancy and lactation. It is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy and lactation. Now the second condition where it should not be used in Graves' disease is patients having moderate to severe active Graves' ophthalmopathy. Again, it is not advisable to use radioactive iodine in these patients with active, moderate to severe active ophthalmopathy because it is said to aggravate this condition. So these two are contraindications or when radioactive iodine should not be used in a patient with Graves' disease. Now, a small, some more details about this radioactive iodine. We have already told that it's very easy to administer, administered orally, a single dose is sufficient. Now, how does this radioactive iodine act? Radioactive iodine emits beta rays. And this beta rays destroys the gland and inevitably in around 4 to 6 months, almost all the patients become hypothyroid and they have to be started on levothyroxine therapy. That's how this radioactive iodine acts. A small mnemonic here I want to add for students not able to remember radioactive iodine emits which rays, alpha, beta or gamma. If you look into the radioactive iodine which is used for thyroid scan, it emits gamma radiation. Now a simple mnemonic for you to remember is, bring in to your mind these three people. The first is a policeman, the second is a terrorist, and third is a detective. What are the characteristics of these three people? Police, they are ineffective. That's why crime rates are high and they are keep on going on in our society. Terrorists, they are destructive, isn't it? Detective is diagnostic. He finds out things and helps detect the crime and things like that. Now, this is alpha ray, this is beta ray, and this is gamma. So, with this simple analogy, so bring in the picture of a police, a terrorist, and a detective, and you can easily remember this thing, you will never confuse it. Right. Now, some more words about this radioactive iodine. The dose, a single dose of 10 to 15 millicuries is sufficient to cure. 10 to 15 millicuries is sufficient for cure. Right. Now, let's go to the second modality of treatment, the pharmacotherapy. Now, what are the strategies for pharmacotherapeutic approach? There are 4 or 5 strategies. Let us see one by one and let's see which strategy is preferred. The first strategy is block of uptake of iodine. The second strategy is inhibition of synthesis. The third strategy is block of release of the hormone. The fourth strategy is prevention of peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. The last strategy is symptomatic, where it is done by usually blocking the beta receptors. Now let's see quickly about each of these strategies and see which is best and which is suited for what. Now, blocking the uptake of iodine can be done by perchlorates and thiocyanates. Now, thiocyanates, the cruciferous family vegetables like cabbage, cauliflower have thiocyanates and they block the uptake of iodine and they cause excess intake can cause hypothyroidism, but they are not used in therapy. Potassium perchlorate is available as there, but it is not used clinically because it causes aplastic anemia. So this strategy of blocking the uptake of iodine is not used clinically. Now coming to inhibition of synthesis, this is one of the most effective strategies available. We have a group of drugs called thioamides. This is the most effective. Now, block of release, the iodides can block the release of the hormone. They can be of, we can use organic iodides, we can use inorganic iodides. Organic are basically radio contrast media containing iodine, example lipodate, and we have inorganic potassium iodide. A small note of this group or this strategy is that it cannot be used alone, because after some time of therapy, if it is used alone, the gland will escape from the block, the iodide block, what is called as iodide escape, and paradoxically it can increase the release. So this is also not a preferred strategy, using it alone. Peripheral conversion of T4 to T3 can be accomplished by propylthiouracil. It can be done with propranolol, corticosteroids, and iodides also. Now, if you look into this point, propranolol at a dose of more than 160 milligrams per day only, at a high dose, mostly we might not be using at this level for the treatment of the toxicosis. This point is exploited, it's not exploited in the routine management, but used only in the management of a patient with thyroid storm. This is one condition where propylthiouracil is preferred over metimazole. We'll see that a little bit later. Now, the last way is symptomatic treatment with beta blockers, propranolol, atenolol, or sometimes in patients in whom beta blockers are contraindicated, we can use calcium channel blocker, diltiazem. Say for example, a patient with bronchial asthma in which you cannot use propranolol, you can go in for a calcium channel blocker, diltiazem. Now if you look into these five strategies, we have already told this is not used. This also cannot be used as a single treatment because it can have a paradoxical effect. This has a very minor role to play. Now if you look into the most effective strategy we have seen is inhibition of synthesis. So this is the strategy which is actually employed as far as pharmacotherapy of Graves' disease goes. A small implication is that this causes inhibition of synthesis. What is the implication is that it always has a time lag of at least 2 weeks. So the therapeutic point which we get out of is that this is always coupled with beta blockers. So initially when you start on beta blockers and on thiamines, and after the effect starts, you can wean down the beta blockers. So this is the strategy which has to be followed. So now we have seen that thiamines are preferred. Let's go into this group. What are the drugs available and which drug is preferred among these? Now if you look into the group as such, it has three drugs. The first drug is propylthiouracil. The second drug is carbimazole. The third drug is metimazole. Now if you look into these three, the carbimazole is a precursor and it is converted into metimazole, and all the actions of carbimazole are through metimazole. So we have propylthiouracil and we have metimazole, carbimazole. Among these two, metimazole and carbimazole is preferred. Why propylthiouracil is not preferred? There are three reasons why is it not preferred. The first and the most important reason is the safety concern or the ADRs. FDA has issued a black box warning for propylthiouracil as it causes severe fulminant hepatitis. Fatal hepatitis can be caused. This is one of the safety issues. The other adverse drug reactions, namely other serious adverse drug reactions like agranulocytosis, have a higher incidence in PTU. So the incidence is higher with PTU than compared to metimazole or carbimazole. So that's the first reason. The second reason is a kinetic reason. Propylthiouracil needs to be administered 3 times a day, whereas metimazole can be given once a day. That's the second reason. The third reason is cost. Propylthiouracil is higher in cost when compared to metimazole and carbimazole. So these are the three reasons why metimazole or carbimazole is the preferred antithyroid drug for treatment of Graves' disease. So we have seen which is the preferred drug. Now, having seen that, does propylthiouracil have an edge over metimazole or carbimazole? If so, what is that? Now we have already seen one property that propionyl thiouracil can block peripheral conversion, whereas metimazole, carbimazole cannot. Now where propionyl thiouracil is preferred over metimazole in two indications. One is first trimester of pregnancy, propionyl thiouracil is preferred. The reason being, propionyl thiouracil is much highly protein bound and less amount crosses placenta than compared to carbimazole and metimazole. That's the first indication. The second indication is it is preferred in thyroid storm. Two reasons why is it preferred. One is because it can prevent peripheral conversion. Second is it is available in intravenous formulation. Thyroid storm is an emergency and we need to give drugs intravenously. So these are the two reasons why propionyl thiouracil is preferred over metimazole in thyroid storm. So we have seen which drug and when propionyl thiouracil is preferred. Now let's see how much to start with. Now if you look into the treatment strategy for treatment method for Graves' disease, thyrotoxicosis due to Graves' disease, we start with a high dose, then we slowly taper down to a low dose. Start with a high dose and slowly taper down to a low dose. Now there are some rough guidelines of dose per day for metimazole, and this is based on free T4 level. Now we need to start, the starting dose is 5 to 10 milligrams per day if the level is 1 to 1.5 times the normal level of what? Free T4 level. We start with 10 to 20 milligrams if it is 1.5 to 2 times the normal limit. And we might start with around 30 to 40 milligrams if it is 2 to 3 times the normal limit. These are again rough guidelines which will help us to select the dose. Now, so having selected the dose, now a small note, 10 milligram of carbimazole can give an equivalent concentration to 6 milligrams of metimazole. This is the conversion for carbimazole and metimazole. Right. Now, let us see, so how much to start we have seen. So, let us see how to monitor or what to monitor before we start therapy and during treatment what to monitor. Two laboratory parameters mandatory have to be monitored before we start therapy with metimazole or carbimazole. Before we go on to that, a small note about this metimazole and carbimazole. Metimazole is available in US. Carbimazole is primarily available in UK and Australia. Now if you look into in India, both metimazole and carbimazole are available. The trade name of carbimazole in UK as well as in India is Metimus. And trade name of carbimazole is neomercazole. Both in UK as well as in India, carbimazole goes by the trade name of neomercazole, and metimazole is available in India in the trade name of metimes. Right. Now let us see what are the things to be monitored before we start therapy. Two parameters needs to be mandatorily monitored. The first one is liver function test. And the second parameter is complete blood count. Now, why do we need to monitor these two? Because the we have seen that one of the important adverse effects of this metimazole is neutropenia, and the levels of neutrophil count are said to vary with the disease itself. So, to get a baseline, so that we can at times when the patient complains of symptoms suggestive of agranulocytosis, to come to a conclusion whether count has reduced or not, we need a baseline. So we need complete blood count. Same way, it can cause jaundice and elevation of transaminase level. The disease per se can also cause some variation. So to differentiate that and to have a baseline to find out whether there is significant elevation from the baseline, we need to measure transaminases levels, the bilirubin levels, complete blood count, the neutrophil, the differential count, everything needs to be there before we start therapy. Right. Now, how to monitor the patient who is started, when to monitor. Right. Now, we have already seen there is a lag period of at least 2 weeks for metimazole, carbimazole. Now, we can start monitoring after 4 to 6 weeks of starting the therapy. What needs to be monitored? The dose needs to be titrated initially with either free T4 or preferably T3, total T3 or free T3. Now, why TSH, if you look into TSH, in the initial periods of treatment, of initiating treatment with metimazole, TSH is not a good marker because it remains suppressed even after euthyroid state is released for months, especially in the initial period. So in the initial period, this is not a good marker, and hence that titration is not possible with TSH. Free T3 can be done. In some patients, T4 might be normal, but T3 level might be very low. It may be very high, indicating that there is ongoing thyrotoxicosis. So T3 levels, titrating on T3 levels is more preferable than titrating with free T4 levels. Right. Now, what to do? Once euthyroid level has been attained, we can reduce the dose by 30 to 50%, and after reducing the we have already told that once we start on a high dose, we try to, once euthyroid state is changed, we try to reduce it, and with the lowest possible dose we have to maintain. So once we try to reduce again, after we reduce again 4 to 6 weeks, we can check the level and try to titrate as the lowest possible dose which has to be used. So what to monitor before treatment and during treatment we have seen. Now, how long treatment should be continued? Once we have attained euthyroid state, it is advised to continue treatment for at least 12 to 18 months. So how long it should be continued? So it is for 12 to 18 months. Once we have continued the drug for 12 to 18 months, we can check if TSH levels and the TSH receptor antibody levels are normal or negative, we can stop treatment. So these two are normal, or this is negative and low titers, we can stop. Now what happens if this TSH receptor antibodies is still remains elevated? Then you need to continue for one more year. Continue the treatment for one more year, or at this point the patient can opt for radioactive iodine or the other modality, the surgery. So this is how long to continue, and based on what parameters will we decide so to stop after 12 to 18 months of therapy. Now, so how long to continue, when to stop. Before we go on to the remission and relapse, what are the adverse drug reactions to this therapy with metimazole and carbimazole, and what should we do when these adverse reactions appear? So let's go to the adverse drug reactions. So the ADRs, I'll classify them as the most common ADRs with this metimazole and carbimazole. First we'll see that. GI discomfort and vomiting are the common adverse effects seen with that. And how this can be reduced or prevented? Dose division helps in reducing this adverse effect. Dose division also helps in the therapeutics in a way that, say for example, a patient who is going to receive 30 or 40 milligrams in the initial phase, if we give it as 15 to 20 milligrams BD, there is more effective control achieved, as because the duration of metimazole is not 24 hours but certainly less than that. So BD dosing is always possible, and if we do that, they can achieve more better control and more quicker control. So that way also dose division can help. Dose division can help in reducing this adverse effect. Another most common adverse effect is maculopapular rash. Antihistamines can be used to control this adverse effect, and there is no need to stop the drug therapy if this adverse effect appears. So these two are the most common adverse effects. Now coming to the most serious adverse effect as far as metimazole therapy goes, the first and the most serious is agranulocytosis. Before we start therapy, we have already told that we have to measure the complete bed count, the neutrophil, DC, differential count, everything. Now, one more instruction which needs to be given in writing to the patient who started on metimazole, carbimazole is that if a patient has fever, sore throat or mouth ulcers, he should immediately stop the drug and return back to the physician for investigation, the count, as well as for the throat sap. Why? Because this is a sign of agranulocytosis, and if not detected and treated early, it can be fatal. So agranulocytosis is one of the most serious complications, but one reassuring point is that it is almost always reversible. So once we have confirmed that this is agranulocytosis, we have to give antibiotics as per the throat swab culture report. We have to give granulocyte colony stimulating factor to improve the counts and to reduce fever, paracetamol and other antipyretics, cooling, all these things to be done. Right. Now, one more important point is, if a patient encounters agranulocytosis, then you have to stop the drug and do not restart. Do not restart. It's a very important thing. It should not be restarted. Also, please remember that there is cross-reactivity between propylthioaerosyl and metimazole. If a patient is on metimazole, there is no point in you having or making a trial of changing to propylthioaerosyl and seeing. So both drugs should not be used if the patient encounters agranulocytosis. The second serious adverse effect which can be seen with metimazole, carbimazole is cholestatic jaundice and elevation of liver enzymes. If the liver enzyme elevation is more than 3 times the normal limit, then again we need to stop the drug. So these are the most common and most severe adverse effects. Lastly, we'll see what is or when can we call a patient is in remission and what to do if relapse occurs. Right. Now, after we stop therapy, if the patient is having normal TSH, T3, T4 for 1 year, after we stop, then the patient has gone in for remission. Now, what to do? Here, we need to have 3 month follow up in the first initial year. So once we have stopped, every 3 months we have to follow up the patient. So what to do if the patient again goes in for thyrotoxicosis during this follow up of 1 year or later, that we have to go in for either radioactive iodine or surgery. That will be the treatment if the patient again goes in for a relapse. So that's about it. So to summarize what we have seen in this session, we saw that Graves' disease is the most common cause for thyrotoxicosis. It is an autoimmune disorder with the thyroid stimulating hormone receptor antibodies stimulating the synthesis and secretion. We saw that we have 3 modalities, the pharmacotherapy, radioactive iodine and surgery. We saw that radioactive iodine is the most preferred modality of treatment in the United States, whereas pharmacotherapy is the most preferred treatment in Europe, Japan, Australia and India. We saw that inhibition of synthesis with thiamide is the most effective and the preferred strategy as far as pharmacotherapy goes. Metimazole or carbimazole is the preferred drug. We start with a higher dose and taper down and maintain it on a low dose once euthyroid state is achieved. We have to continue the drug for at least 12 to 18 months, and after that, if the TSH and the thyroid stimulating hormone receptor antibodies are negative or with low titers, we can stop the drug. After stopping, again we need to follow it for 1 month. If it is normal, we say that they are going to remission. And in case they again develop thyrotoxicosis, features of thyrotoxicosis, then we need to go in for radioactive iodine or surgery. So that's all we have seen in this session. So thank you very much. If you have doubts, please get back to us. Bye.